Let me just quickly show you what the mix sounds like for a little bit, and then I'm going to dive into the track overview just very quickly, and then we'll dive into the details about how I mix in each individual track. So I think that's a pretty good overview of how the mix sounds. Now, in regards to the amount of tracks that I had to work with, it was really, really simple. For the drums, I really only had maybe about 20 tracks to work with, maybe even a little bit less than that. I have a kick sample, a snare top, snare bottom, and a snare sample. I have 5 toms. I have a hi-hat, ride, china, overheads, and then 2 different room mics. That's a bit unusual for me, actually. And the room mics actually were such an integral part of the drum sound. I usually only get 1 room track, but somehow we ended up with 2. We have a bass DI. Regarding bass, we have a bass DI. We have a bass mid-gain tone. And then we have a bass distortion tone here, all being routed to a bus here. And then this auxiliary track is for something which I'll show you in a little bit. We have a guitars just left and right. 2 guitars right here, left and right, being bused to this channel here. We have a lead guitar track, which is at the very end here, which is this highlighted section. We have left and right clean guitars, which was some of my favorite clean tones that I have come up with. Now, regarding screams, we have basically the main scream here. We have the backup screams here, and then these are additional backup screams here. And then that's pretty much it in regards to all the tracks that I'm working with. And then everything's being bussed down to my mix bus here. And yeah, let's just dive in and get right to it. All right, so diving into the kick, let's just take a listen to how the kick sounds with the processing, and then I'm going to bypass each plugin, and then we'll go through each one as we go along. That's what the kick sounds like when it's completely processed. Let me just quickly show you what the raw kick sounds like. So the potential is there, but as you can tell, it's very woofy, very dark sounding, not necessarily what we need for this kind of track that we have going on here. So I'm going to just open up my SSL channel here, and I have about an 8K boost, about 7 dB. I have a 4K boost, about 9 dB, and I'm cutting out some mud around 200 Hertz, and then I'm boosting around 60 Hertz. And all of those are very common moves for me. I'm constantly looking around 8K for the high end and 4K for the slap and the click. I'm always looking around maybe 200 and 500 for a lot of that woofiness and that stuff that kind of makes the kick drum sound very flat. And then I'm always boosting around 60 Hertz. Next up in the chain is this Blacksalt Audio Enhance knob. It basically is just a low end enhancer. And the way it does that is by adding harmonic content. It's very similar to like the Waves Max Bass or the R Bass. Unfortunately, it doesn't let you set the frequency that it's adding the harmonic content with. It's a fixed value, but it did the job because I felt that I needed more low end, but by boosting it, it was getting a little bit too boomy. I kind of wanted to just enhance what was already there by using this low control plugin, and it's free, which was really cool. So let me bypass it and then I'll engage it, and you guys can hear a big boost in the low end. So yeah, it's not the type of low end that you get from EQ. It's a different kind of low end, but it gave me the low end that I was looking for. And last in the chain is some extra saturation. While this plugin added harmonic content, this is actually straight up just like saturation and distortion. And when you're kind of hovering around the 10 to 30 mark on this plugin, what it does is actually add low mids in the form of saturation. So it's not EQ adding low mids, it's saturation adding low mids. It's kind of centered in that area, as I felt that I wanted the translation on smaller speakers to be a little bit more apparent on the kick drum. This plugin is phenomenal for doing that. So let me go ahead and bypass that because it's going to be pretty subtle. And then when I'm going to engage it, just pay attention to the low mid sections, not so much the low end, but the low mids. So as you can hear, it got a little bit darker, but from where we were before, it's definitely not the same kind of dark. So yeah, that's pretty much how I process the kick drum, just three plugins, extremely, extremely simple. Now regarding the snare drum, let's just show you guys the raw snare drum really quick, because the raw snare drum also had to be replaced as well. It's pretty tubby, you know, it has a lot of that like kind of weird tubby sound to it, and I just knew that wasn't going to work for this particular mix. So I had a sample replace it, and I chose these two, which is a little bit more kind of a grindcore kind of sound, and then this PK snare direct, which is a bit extreme sounding. And this is actually just tucked in under, so it's not the most prevalent thing here. But let me go ahead and show you guys what that sounds like. So it's still pretty dynamic, but I did want some consistency on the snare, and so that's why I added this one-shot sample here. Now, moving on to the processing on the snare drum. Again, I only have two plugins here, which is this SSL channel. I have a 8K boost. You're going to see a lot of these reoccurring frequencies on my mixes, guys, by the way. 8K, 4K, 2K, a lot of the times you're gonna see me boosting that quite a bit. 2.5K for some mid-range boosting here, and I'm boosting about 200 hertz for about 3 dB. But let's take a quick listen without the EQ, and then I'll engage the EQ, and you guys will hear the changes. So a lot more mid-range, a lot more high-end, and kind of compensating for the low-end loss that you get when you boost that much high-end with this 200 hertz dB boost. Now, I am using, again, similar compression settings here. Slow attack, very fast released. I really just want to emphasize the punch on this snare drum here, and that accomplishing it by doing it on the blast beats, it gives me a little bit more control, because when he starts slamming it on these larger ones, I get a bit more gain reduction and a little bit more punch. But on the blast beats, I'm only doing maybe about 3 dB because I kind of want those to still be a little bit dynamic. Now, moving on to the secret weapon on my snare drum here. This thing, and really any kind of saturation, which is what this is, it's a saturator. I'm using to make it sound louder, but also control the dynamics on the snare drum, because snare drums can be extremely wild. So let me go ahead and play you guys this section here, and I want you guys to pay attention to the meter down here. And look how the meter spikes. And it's very inconsistent, just like up and down, up and down. And you'll see that when I engage this plugin, how the dynamics are gonna be controlled, but it's also gonna sound a little bit louder. See how it kind of spikes? It's almost even kind of be clipping there at the very top there. But if I engage this thing here, you're gonna see that it's gonna sound louder, and now the dynamics are gonna be controlled as well. So I'm getting like almost 12 dB of extra headroom just using this plugin, but I'm not losing any of the perceived volume. Guys, this took me years to understand this. I really, really suggest that you guys start experimenting with using saturation as a way to control dynamics and to increase perceived loudness. So it's a really, really, really cool trick. The snare sample, on the other hand, is gonna sound absolutely ridiculous. And this is more to be of a mid-range bomb. I want the snare sample to have tons of mids, and I want it to be able to just push that snare drum even further into the mix. And I'm doing similar moves here, 8K boost. I'm reducing some of the mid-range because they are a lot to deal with, so I did have to reduce a little bit of that. And some 800 hertz as well, because it was getting a little too papery for me. But I'm not boosting any low end, as again, as this serves more as a mid-range bomb for the snare drum. Let me show you guys what that sounds like without any EQ here. Tons and tons of mids. But if I put this EQ, they're a little bit more controlled, but definitely still has a lot of mid-range there. And again, that's really all I want out of this. And then I'm using, again, my saturation trick on snares. I want it to have a bit more perceived volume. So yeah, definitely sounds a little bit louder with that one there. Okay, moving on to toms. Now, toms are really, really straightforward for me. I'm gonna just show you guys one tom here, because this EQ is pretty much the same on all the other EQs. It's just where they sit in the frequency spectrum for each individual tom that it changes, really. But I'm always going to be looking around 500 hertz to cut something out. And then usually when it comes to toms, I cut right above the fundamental frequency. and make sure that all the low end that is being introduced by the toms is being cut out, except for that fundamental frequency. So for this particular tom, it was around 90 hertz. And then I just go to my SSL channel. Typically, I would have a big boost at 8K, but these toms were pretty bright as they were, so I didn't have to do that on here. But you will see on the bus that I did add some high end just because it still needed it. But on the individual toms, they were doing just fine. So yeah, that's what this EQ is doing. It's taking out a lot of that nasty mid-range. If I bypass this, you'll hear it sound just really muddy. So it has a bit more of a deeper quality when this EQ is engaged. However, the rest of the toms are pretty much the same thing, except for the floor toms. Everything's the same, except I'm adding that harmonic enhancer on the floor toms so that when he does the big booms on the floor toms and these sections here, that it just like sounds like he's slamming them and it sounds really, really big. Let me just show you guys that now. That right there, that big boom. If I was to bypass that harmonic exciter, you would definitely lose a lot of that beef. But let me pop that back in. All that extra punch comes back in. Now on the tom bus, it's pretty straightforward. This is where I am adding a lot of the high-end 8K boost here and about 4K boost here as well. And that's just because, again, the toms were already bright as they were, so I just wanted to go ahead and add a little bit more on the bus itself. And I am adding some compression here with the toms as well. I want them to, when they start doing the drum rolls, to have a very consistent tonality here. And I am not shy about the amount of compression that I'm using here. You can even hear that it's still pretty dynamic. I am using about a 3-to-1 ratio, a pretty fast release, and a pretty slow medium attack. I'm trying to just control a little bit of the transients, kind of squeeze the toms a little bit so they're a little bit more even across the board. And that's pretty much the goal with that. And then I'm adding some more saturation on the toms as well with this revival plugin. And that's it. Oh, and then last but not least, I am adding some clipping here. Moving on to overheads, this is an extreme metal track, guys, so I am cutting out everything below those 700 hertz. I don't need them, I don't want them, they're totally unnecessary for the mix. So everything below 700 hertz is gone bye-bye. And, you know, there was some mid-range stuff happening between 1K and 2K that needed to be taken care of, so I'm just dropping that down a little bit. It was kind of making the mix sound a little bit washy and milky. That's the only way I can describe the frequencies that I'm cutting there. But yeah, it was kind of clouding everything up, so I had to take those out there. And then I'm kind of doing an unusual move for me here as well. I'm doing a bit of a low cut at 16K. The cymbals were really, really bright. I wanted to darken them up a little bit and just kind of get rid of a little bit of that sizzle that was there and then kind of try to get that back in a different way. Let me just show you guys what the overhead sound like here. Bypass this and you guys will hear how crazy these sound. So you can see that the tonality of the cymbals don't really change, but all of that extra boxiness is just gone. I don't need that kind of clouding up my mix there. Now, you also notice that the hi-hat is really where the zing is, and that was killing me, so I had to take that out, and that's why these two little moves here are there. I am compressing them slightly, and I do mean slightly. So only on certain hits is it really spiking, and that's just because I want to control and add some consistency to the cymbals. I don't want to actually compress them. I just want to make sure that if they're getting smacked, that I am kind of bringing the transients down a little bit to make them a little bit more even. And then from there, I'm using the infamous soothe. There was still a little bit of weirdness that I felt was going on with the cymbals, and I wanted to smooth them out. So I pulled out some soothe, and that's what I used to get that effect. So what I did there was I flipped the delta, and that's what's being taken out. And as you can hear, it's just a lot of these weird ringing kind of sounds that were bugging me in the mix. So I used this to take that out. And last of the chain is just a limiter. That's really all I have here, just to make sure that if anything crazy happens, that this limiter is catching it. Now let's check out the entire drum mix right now. We're gonna check out the drum mix, and then I'm gonna mute these room tracks because I really want you guys to hear what it's adding to the drum mix as a whole. Okay, so pretty much all of the mid-range is gone and it sounds very separated. But the most important thing, if you guys were paying attention, that you'll notice is that weird pillowy kind of sound on the low end. I usually don't do that on my drum mixes. I usually tend to take kind of those frequencies out, but I decided to try a little bit of an experiment on this particular mix because I felt like I was lacking some beef in the low end on the kick drum especially. And I saw a mentor of mine say that he sometimes gets a little bit of the low end from the room tracks. And I know this is a technical death metal track, and the kick drums are insanely fast. But again, I really wanted that low end to have kind of like that punch and kind of that, I don't know, I couldn't describe it, but I knew somehow in my gut that I was gonna get those out of the room tracks. So let me just quickly just solo the room tracks and show you guys what I'm working with here. Hey, that's room track one. Let's try room track two. And so this is a farther microphone than this one. This microphone is up to the drum kit, and this one's a little bit farther away. So they're kind of just giving you a bit of different spatial imaging here, but they're both, in my opinion, doing the same thing, which is adding space to the drums and adding some pillowy characteristics to the low end here. So here's my dead simple EQ. There was some low mid stuff happening there on the close room mic here, and then the cymbals were killing me, so I took them out on the 4K area there. So let's go ahead and bypass that and show you guys. So it just kind of cleans it up a little bit while still retaining a majority of the characteristics here. Now the SSL channel is where a lot of the big moves are happening. 60K cut and then 8K cut as well. So everything above 8K is gone and everything below 60 hertz is being chopped off as well. Usually on a room track, I'm going up to maybe about 100, sometimes even as low as 90, but definitely this is more common than not. But as I previously mentioned, I did want to influence the low end a little bit more regarding the room tracks across the board. All right, so I have a mid-range bump about 1.5K. This adds a lot of the character of the room track with this move here. And then as you can see here, 80 hertz. I'm boosting tons and tons of 80 hertz. That is, again, not common for me, but I had a goal and I had to do whatever I could to get to that goal. And adding that extra 80 hertz with that 8 dB boost was gonna help me get to that low end that I was looking for on the drums here. So let me go ahead and bypass the EQ and let's take a listen. So yeah, the big two are that mid-range boost and then that low-end boost. That's what's gonna help it retain the character in the mix. Now going on to the second room track, it's really the same thing. I'm just trying to control the cymbals here with at around 4K. There was some low-mid stuff happening again that I needed to take out, and then some extra weird low-mid-range stuff as well here. Again, 1.5 on the SSL being boosted, and then again that 80 hertz boost on the low-end. So pretty much nothing crazy here. Let's go ahead and show you guys what that sounds like. I'm gonna bypass the EQ. So there's not as much low end as there is on the other room track. So this one's being more used for mid-range to add to the entire drum kit. Now let me show you guys what the whole drum kit sounds like with that EQ completely turned off. it's kind of thin, the kick drum is not really doing it for me, but if I pop them back in, all of that extra low end comes back in such a cool way. I'm definitely gonna start experimenting with doing my drums a little bit more like this. All right, we spent enough time on the drums here, guys. Let's go ahead and take a listen to Bassland. So bass is really, really simple for me. I got three things going on here. I got a bass DI, which is like a clean bass sound. I got parallax here for some like mid-gain tones. And then I got this cool free plugin for some more of a distortion tones. Take a quick listen to what our bass sounds like. So those three tracks accumulate to that entire bass tone. Now, all of those tracks are being bussed to this bass bus here. Let me quickly show you guys what that bass sounds like without any processing whatsoever. Not too bad, but if I pop in all the plugins back in, the timbre didn't change too much, but what you did here is a lot more of a consistent and even low end, which is what you want for metal. You basically want to turn your bass guitar almost into a synth when it comes to metal. All right, so let's dive in right away with this SSL channel here. This is a common boost for me here, about 1.5K. I want to add those mids so that the bass guitar mid-range can kind of cut through the mix. I'm adding a little bit more mid-range at 2.2K, which is not common for me, but I felt like it needed it because I wasn't hearing the growl of the bass in the mix as much as I wanted. Now, I am cutting around 500 hertz, 400 hertz or whatever, quite significantly, around minus 9 dB almost. But then I am boosting it back up at 75 hertz with 2.9 dB of gain here. So let me bypass the EQ and let's take a listen. So really simple, it's just kind of cleaning things up and not really trying to change too much of the tone as I got the tone I wanted with the original three tracks here. Moving on to compression, it's pretty standard for me here, and I'm using a medium attack to let a little of the front end through, but then I'm using a fast release to kind of just make sure that, you know, it's punching and hitting very hard for a bass guitar. So you could hear when he does those sweeps, I wanted those to be pretty even. So I had to use a lot of compression to get that done. If I was to bypass this plugin here, you'll see that the bass ends up being a little bit more lumpy and inconsistent and a lot more dynamic. Moving on to escalator. I wanted to add some low mids saturation, so I just did that, very similar to what happened with the kick. And here is a secret weapon plugin that I just picked up not too long ago, so it's a bit new to me, but nevertheless, it's very similar to what I used to do with the Waves C4 plugin, but a little bit different at the same time. So I'm compressing everything below 100 hertz, right? And then I'm bringing it back up about 6 dB. So let's go ahead and solo the low end and let me show you guys what this is doing. And all those extra frequencies below 100 hertz are being compressed to ever living hell and then being brought back up. This alone is what's gonna help you get that bass to be very consistent. If you're not kind of doing something like this, which you can do with the C4 from Waves, you know, your bass is always going to have a bit of a lumpy kind of sound to it, especially for technical death metal. You kind of want it to be a synthesizer at this point. So this plugin allows me to kind of do a 2-for-1, because what I used to do is follow up the Waves plugin with the Max Bass or the R Bass from Waves. But this has a harmonic enhancer built in. So I now have one plugin versus two or three doing the same thing. And so this harmonic enhancement plugin is doing exactly what it sounds like. It's enhancing the harmonic frequencies around 80 hertz to have it cut through smaller speakers. And in the mix, this makes a massive difference. You definitely can hear the low end kind of just disappear if I don't have that harmonic enhancer in there. Lastly, I have a limiter there just to catch some peaks as well. Just want it to be a little bit more consistent as well. But let me show you guys what happens if I bypass this plugin in the mix. You'll see the bass disappear quite significantly. So yeah, the low end kind of just falls apart if I don't have this plugin engaged, and I highly recommend you guys look into it because it's a really, really good one. Moving on to guitars, which I'm assuming everyone was waiting for. I am using an amp sim. Kiss my butt if you guys don't like using amp sims. But I am using an amp sim, and this amp sim is the STL Tone Hub. That is the raw tone that I came up for this. I wanted it to have a bit of a mid-range kind of vibe to it, but also still have a bit of a old school kind of sound to it, you know, kind of harkening back to the Behemoth Evangelion kind of days. When it comes to guitars, it's pretty simple for me. A slight boost at 8K, it's pretty simple for me. I am cutting everything below 100 hertz and a slight boost at 1.5K, and that's it. That's pretty much it for this plugin. It's just a little bit tweaking. Let me show you what that sounds like. So I just wanted to add some mid-range and kind of brighten it up a little bit. That's really all that was for this plugin. Now, there's some weird whistling happening here, so all these little dips and stuff, although it may look crazy, it's really not. I'm not even doing anything more than a dB and a half on each individual one, but there was a ton of weird whistling that I needed to get out. So let me go ahead and play that for you, and pay attention, because when I bypass it, you'll hear all this whistling kind of come back up. So it's not changing the tone at all. It's just taking away a lot of those weird, you know, high-end sizzles that I wasn't enjoying. And then we have a C4 multiband compressor here controlling the palm mutes and stuff. This is the Andy Sneap trick. Everyone should know that by now. I'm not going to go over it. And however, I will go over this. Now, this plugin here is something that I started doing a couple years ago thanks to Jordan Valeriot. And this is a compressor on heavy guitars. Yeah, crazy, I know. What the hell are you doing using compression on heavy guitars? Well, guys, to be completely honest with you, this is an awesome compressor to use on guitars, especially if you're looking to get the mid-range up to the forefront and kind of smooth things out a little bit. So if you want to get your guitars to sound a little bit louder without them actually being louder, this plugin is a great way to do that. It emphasizes the mid-range and kind of smooths out the top end in such a really cool way. I don't know of any other plugin that does what this does. So let me play it for you guys. I'm gonna have it bypassed for now, and then I'm gonna pop it in and then just kind of hear how the guitars get pushed forward a little bit and kind of a little bit smoother. So it's extremely subtle, guys, but the guitarists tend to lose a little bit of their aggressiveness when I don't have this compressor engaged. And last, I have a limiter just to control a little bit of the extra peaks, shaving off a little bit, giving me a bit more headroom. So nothing crazy on that. And regards to the screaming vocals, it's going to be very brief because pretty much for me, once I kind of get the main vocals done, I just kind of copy the same settings across the board for the rest of the tracks and only making extremely minor tweaks without really changing much, if anything at all. Now, these chains do look a little bit insane, but let me show you guys what's happening here. So a lot of distortion, tons of compression. It's just dripping with distortion. And that's exactly what I wanted with these. When it comes to death metal vocals, unless the vocalist inherently has these characteristics and tonalities, you want to just really slam your vocals with processing because that's what's going to get them up front and in the mix and above everything else, because there's so much going on with the guitars, the bass, and the drums that your vocals have very little room left to play with. And by using tons of compression and saturation and distortion, you are creating the illusion that it's going to be a lot more aggressive and upfront than it really is. So let's go ahead and bypass this entire chain. Let's pull up our handy dandy SSL channel, creating some of the highs here at 8K again. Like I said, guys, in the beginning, you're gonna see a lot of these reoccurring frequencies for me because they just work, right? So it's something that I'm always going back to. So 8K for the high end, 4K for a lot of the more intelligibility here, and then some 2K for more of the aggressive mid range. I'm cutting out some low end at about 185 hertz. And then I'm cutting everything about 16K and above away. I don't want that extra air there. I want that for the cymbals. And then everything below 100 hertz is also being destroyed. So I'm going to take a listen to the, and then I'm going to bypass the EQ while it's playing so you guys can hear how it pretty much gets dark. So yeah, man, I mean, you just really need to get rid of all of that extra low end. The vocals are very, very dark. This 2K boost honestly is the star of the show here. Yeah, I'm adding high end and some intelligibility with these two moves here, but this is really what's going to make it cut through the mix. This 2K boost here. Now, as you saw on the right side here, I am also compressing super, super crazy. Fast attack, fast release, because I want it to just clamp down on those transients. I want it to just kind of bring it down and just clamp it down because these vocals were very, very dynamic sounding. And I just want to make sure that when I am compressing it, that I'm bringing up all of the little details as much as I can with that compression. And moving on to the main vocal compressor, which is again my 1176 recreation here, you're gonna see how much I'm actually doing here. Gobs and gobs of vocal compression going on here. Medium attack, fast release. I want to emphasize the front end words of attack. With the SSL, I'm trying to clamp down on the transients, but with the 76, now I'm just trying to reintroduce them in a way that's going to make the vocal punch through the mix. And by having a medium attack and fast release, you're kind of emphasizing that front end attack of the vocals because I want him to sound like he's attacking that microphone. Now I'm just de-essing a little bit, just making sure none of the S's and T's and pops and all that are getting out of control. And here is the distortion plugin that I'm using, the SSL saturator yet again. Let's go ahead and play that for you guys, and I'm going to bypass it. And I'm doing, again, that same kind of thing. I'm trying to make it sound louder than it really is while still controlling a lot of the dynamics that happens within the vocal performance. Okay, let me bypass that for you guys. So as you can clearly see, it sounds louder, but if you look at the meter, it actually stayed the same, right? There's no additional extra gain being added, but it does sound louder. So I really love this plugin for the ability to do that. There's some C4 going on because there was extra low mids that I didn't find were particularly useful for this particular mix. So I decided to use the guitar C4 Andy Sneap trick on the vocals themselves. So it's only acting on certain times and only on those offending frequencies here. And then I just got a limiter to shave off any additional peaks. And that's pretty much it for vocals. Now I just decided to copy the same settings because it's the exact same performance on this secondary track here. And so these settings are the same as they are on this particular track as well. So I'm going to bypass that entire chain so you guys can hear the vocals in their entirety. I really hope you guys can hear the power that extreme compression on your vocals is actually useful for, because if I bypassed it, you guys didn't hear any vocals. They completely disappeared. There is no intelligibility whatsoever. When it comes to extreme vocals, guys, the name of the game is saturation and compression. Again, the name of the game is saturation and compression. Without that compression and saturation, you're never going to get them to sound upfront and aggressive, just like we have done in this particular mix. All right, so onto the mix bus. I have a very simple chain here. I just have my SSL compressor. I have some saturation. I have my mastering EQ and a bit of dynamic EQ, and then my limiter here. So let's take a quick listen to the mix without any processing whatsoever. I will leave the limiter on there just to make sure that it's still the same volume for you guys, and then I'll go through each individual plugin here. So it sounds good, but you know, the snare is a little bit on top of everything. The kick drum seemed to be on top of a bit of everything. The drums seem to be overpowering just a bit much of everything. And the guitars don't seem to be up as front as much as I would like. Now that I've engaged this compressor and I play back the mix for you guys should hear that everything kind of just congeals together in a very pleasant way, gets squeezed in a way where all the elements start being less separated and working more together as one unit. So I love this compressor, a threshold, ratio 4:1, attack 10 milliseconds, and release on auto mode. These are classic settings for many genres, especially for myself when it comes to metal. Almost 4 dB of gain reduction, and that's pretty much it. In regards to the saturation, which is this tape machine here, it's doing something. It's just kind of controlling the mid-range and adding a little bit of more sizzle at the top. Let's go ahead and engage that. So it's just introducing some mid-range, and that's really all I was looking for with that particular plugin. Now, this is something that I started doing recently. I don't ever really EQ or do any kind of dynamic processing on my mixes, but I felt like I was close to the mix that the client wanted, but I wasn't just quite there yet. So let me show you guys what I did here. A small boost at 30 hertz just to bring up the super subs, a dB boost, you know? I'm bringing up some of the lower end of the upper mid range for about a dB. I wanted to add a little bit more mid range because I did so much scooping, and I wanted to introduce some more zing and some more kind of high end air. So around 13K ish, I'm adding about a dB of boosting there. So let me show you guys what that sounds like. It's extremely subtle, guys. Again, I'm only doing a dB move here and there. This is something not I normally do, but I felt like I could get away with it a little bit, so I decided to go for it, and I was pretty happy with the results. And then I'm using a dynamic EQ to control certain sections of the mix under certain times. So let's take a listen to what this is doing here. So as you can see here, it's controlling tons of the low mid section. That's because I used tons of saturation that introduced those low mids that they got a little bit out of control. So I didn't want to remove them in a static way with EQ. I wanted to just have them be controlled on a more dynamic level. So they kind of interact and have that push pull kind of thing going on with compression. And so I'm using a dynamic EQ to kind of get that effect on the low mid area. Because if I was to just kind of dip them out with static EQ, then really I'm defeating the whole purpose of me introducing those frequencies to begin with. Now, again, there is still some harshness happening here, but I didn't want to have anything removed anymore with a static EQ. So I felt like a dynamic EQ here would be sufficient, only really acting on the offending frequencies. But that's pretty much it, guys. After that, I just have my limiter and we're done. We're done with the mix. That's my walkthrough for how I mixed a technical death metal mix. I know it was a very lengthy video, guys, and I appreciate you guys sticking with me if you guys made it through all the way at the end. But I wanted to just kind of briefly show you guys how a typical mix might look for me, because this was a very simple song. There's not a lot of elements, and it's just common principles, right? So what did we kind of see across this mix? Tons of slow attack and fast release compression, tons of saturation used for dynamic control, enhancing, as well as making things sound louder than they really are. The creative use of EQ to filter out any low end that you may not need and kind of control the mid-range elements using EQ. The vocals having to need tons and tons of compression to get up front and in your face and in the mix. And really the unique aspect of the mix would be the drum room tracks that I have, you know, adding that low end on the room tracks and introducing them in a way where they don't destroy the clarity of the mix, but allowing them to enhance the low end of the drums themselves. So I hope you guys can get some insights and kind of take this as a way to try some of these moves on your mixes. And I really enjoy kind of making these videos for you guys. So if you guys have any questions, leave me a comment below. I'll see you guys in the next one.